featuring the internationally acclaimed inventor of the Benatti spine procedures, Alfred Benatti, MD. Once again, here are Dr. Benatti and your host, Kimberly Brummel.
Well, Dr. Benatti is hard at work, and I'm here. I'm Kimberly Brummel, joined by my friend Ethan Uecker.
Glad to be here.
And Jeff Wagstaff.
Hey, Kimberly, thanks for having me.
Absolutely. And we have another doctor from the Benatti Spine Institute who is joining us on the radio program, Dr. David Hershauer. Thank you for sharing your time with us.
Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. So, you know, every week we talk about back pain, neck pain, migraines, that aching, agonizing pain that just doesn't go away with conservative type treatments. When you fall into that category, you don't need to live life in pain. And if you've sought out other surgeons and they say that there's no hope, don't listen. You don't have to be hooked on pain pills for the rest of your life. And you also don't need to be conned into hardware fusion surgeries offered by, you know, those lesser spine institutes that are out there. Make sure you reach out to Benatti at Benatti.com. We have an exciting show lined up for you. We're going to talk about the Obamacare repeal discussion. We have a lady that I actually connected with on Facebook, and she wants to remain anonymous because she had an in with insurance companies. Her name is Anne. And then we're going to be talking about medicine, mindfulness, and humanity.
Basically how the doctor-patient relationship has just gone to crap.
Correct.
In the past, like, 30, 50 years.
Yes.
And this doctor knows a way to get that back on track.
And we can't wait to hear all about it. Uh-huh. And then we'll talk more with Dr. David Hershauer from the Benatti Spine Institute. Kind of a meet and greet. Mm-hmm. But up first.
In today's Back to Life segment, we will talk to a patient of the Benatti Spine Institute who went from living a life that was restricted by pain and discomfort through their journey of finding the Benatti Spine Institute and are now living pain-free.
It is my pleasure to introduce to the program Tim Warner from Wellsboro, Pennsylvania. Thanks for joining us on the show.
Thank you.
So why don't you tell us when you first came to be in pain and how did that occur?
In 1997, I was working as a correctional officer and a police officer.
Okay.
We had an incident at our prison with a mental health prisoner. We were going to segregate him from other inmates.
Sure.
And when we went in to do it, he kind of exploded on us. I ended up getting in a wrestling match with him, and I fell backwards and hit a mop bucket and a ringer and fractured my back.
Oh, goodness. What did you do at that point? Because that sounds awfully painful.
Well, I went to the local emergency room. They'd done films. They'd done MRIs.
Okay.
It was a real fine fracture, and it was hard to see. So from there, I ended up going to a pain clinic and having injections and cryo burns and all sorts of stuff.
Wow. When you talk about the pain, can you describe it for those that are listening? Where on your body was it? And was it a localized pain? Was it a shooting, radiating pain?
It was a radiating pain from my back down into my legs.
Okay.
It was like a cramping, tingling sensation.
Yeah. And how long did that pain last? Or did it never go away?
Oh, my word.
Quite some time.
When they did the cryo burn, that helped for like 8 months, I think it was. But they wouldn't do another one.
Sure.
And so I looked into having a fusion done at that point.
Okay. And did you actually go through with the fusion?
Yes. In 2000, December of 2000, I had a fusion of S1, L5 area.
Okay.
And that seemed to take care of most of it for about 4 years.
Okay.
And it wasn't until after I had the fusion, they told me, well, you know, this was going to put pressure on the next disc.
Mm-hmm.
And 4 years later, the disc above it went bad.
Wow. Did you have more limited range of motion once you did the fusion?
I had limited range, yes. Yeah. Once they fuse it, you don't bend there anymore.
Right. So what did you do at that point? So there you are. It was okay for 4 years, and then you started having more problems.
I looked into other procedures. I live right on the New York border.
Okay.
And there was a hospital in New York that were doing artificial discs.
Mm-hmm.
And as I looked into doing those, it seemed to make more sense. And I thought maybe that would protect other discs from going bad. So
right.
In 2005, I had an artificial disc implanted.
Wow. So you've been through a lot. So you have rods and screws and artificial discs in your back. You know, we've done research on it, and a one-level fusion has about 60 to 65% failure. And when two or three fusions levels are done in fusion, that number goes all the way up to 85% failure rate. Mm-hmm. And even And even those that may have gone well to begin with, it's like 70-something percent end up failing.
Sure.
Wow. So what do you do at that point? You've gone through and had the artificial discs. How did you find Bonatti? Can you explain that?
After I'd had the artificial disc put in, I started physical therapy, and they had me doing these lunges. And I think it was within 2 weeks of the surgery, the artificial disc had moved. And when it slid, it was pinching a nerve. So I kept going back and complaining, you know, I was still having pain, and they couldn't see it on the x-rays. Everything seemed to be lined up right.
So
they referred me to another doctor up in Hamilton, New York, for a second opinion. I seen him, and he had seen that the disc had moved, told me about it. His recommendation was to fuse the artificial disc in place. So I asked him if he would do it. So I end up getting two more fusions done after the artificial disc. I came back. I went to work. I was still in pain, but I wanted to do something to occupy my time. So I did go back to work. I couldn't work in law enforcement anymore. They put me in an office job. But I was still having pain. I had pretty much given up on any hope of getting it fixed. We talked to several surgeons in our area, and basically every one of them said there was nothing else that could be done, that I had to learn to live with the pain.
And you didn't want to do that. And just for the sake of time, because we only have about 5 minutes or so left, there you are in pain. You've been through these invasive procedures. You're still in pain. Doctor's saying there's no hope. Somehow you find Bonatti. Why don't we go from that point where you... Where you hear about Bonatti?
Well, not being able to sleep at night, I would go on the internet and try to find someone that could help me. That's when I came across the Bonatti website. And that's how I found them. I ended up sending my films there. Dr. Grossmith returned my call, told me what could be done, and I came down for an office visit.
And when you were there, what did you think about the in-person evaluation? Did you have to name where your pain was from, or did they seem to know the source of the pain?
They could tell me pretty much what was going on. It was incredible. It really was.
And what did you think about being able to finally relieve your pain? Because you're being told nothing can be done. There you are. You know the procedures can help. You finally have a doctor in front of you that knows your pain. You know during the surgery, there is going to be something called conscious IV sedation, where at certain points, they interact with you. And I realize conscious IV sedation works on everyone differently. Some have clearer memories than others. But... you know, do you understand why they use conscious IV sedation?
Oh, definitely.
So they get that interaction? And when did you feel a relief of the pain that brought you in? Some people feel it in the operating room. Some feel it maybe a day or so later or later that day. What was that experience like for you?
It wasn't until I was in the recovery room. I don't remember much about the procedures.
That's okay.
Bits and pieces I remember.
Sure.
The recovery room was when I noticed the most.
All right. And did you...
It was like an awe, you know, the pain was gone.
Did you think that was going to be possible, given the fact you had been through those other procedures before with less than desirable results?
No, I have to tell you, I was very skeptical when we went there.
Right.
You know, in today's world, you don't always get what you see.
It
was totally incredible, though. I mean, everything was true. Everything they told me.
And what was the recovery process like for you, and how are you doing now?
Well, it's a lot different than conventional surgery. Mm-hmm. Conventional surgery takes a year to recover.
Okay.
With the Benatti procedures, you go in at 9 o'clock, and by noon you're having lunch with your family.
Well, Tim, I want to ask you, it sounds like you really went through a roller coaster of emotions with a lot of different treatment. After everything that you've been through, how do you feel? Do you have confidence in recommending the Benatti Institute to someone who might be in your shoes?
Oh, I do, and I have.
Well, we like to hear that, for sure.
And are you finally able to do some of the things you weren't able to do before?
Oh, definitely.
Just name a couple.
Just standing straight and walking is one. Prior to the procedure, I couldn't stand straight. Every morning, my muscles were so tight, I could barely walk.
Yeah.
That's all gone now.
You said you used to be up all night on the internet. Are you sleeping better now?
Yes. I'm still healing from the last two procedures I have, but they've made a big difference.
Well, that's great. And make sure you send us photos. We always like to see everyone who has regained their strength and they're back in motion doing the things they love.
I sure will.
Thank you so much for being on the program.
So thank you.
Thanks a lot, Tim. Have a good weekend.
Bye-bye.
You too. Bye-bye.
See ya.
Those stories never get old.
No, not at all.
Because, and that poor man was through so many invasive procedures. It just proves the point again. Rods, screws, plates, artificial discs. Leave those things far away from your back, and they're just meant for a tool case.
Mm-hmm.
Leave them in your garage. If you have problems with your back or neck, reach out to Benatti at Benatti.com. Call 855-267-0483. Coming up after the break, we're going to talk Obamacare repeal. Love that topic. Doc is going to be so upset he's not here.
Yes, he is.
Make sure you stay tuned. You're listening to American Medicine Today.
This is the first time that I am pain-free after 18 years, and it's just wonderful. I love it.
Phenomenal results, no pain whatsoever.
My pain is virtually gone, nothing short of a miracle.
Those surgeries gave me my life back.
Already, I feel like a new person.
I'm going home new. I can chase my grandbaby now, I can garden, I can cook, and I'm really thrilled. The outcome's been remarkable.
I feel 100% better.
It's like a miracle.
It was phenomenal. It literally did change my life.
I was in a wheelchair at that time, and I left here walking.
Every single pain that I had when I came here is gone.
I'm ready to go home and feel great. This place is great. Thank you.
Everything that they said they would do, they have done, and I'm very, very satisfied and happy with those results.
I knew in surgery, in fact, I told the surgeon when he relieved the pain off the nerve.
The pain is gone. I'm feeling wonderful.
I have no pain. I feel better than I felt in 4 years from the surgery. It was almost immediate relief.
Today I am totally pain-free, which is just amazing. It's fantastic.
It definitely works. I mean, I really don't know what else to tell you. I'm happy.
Listening to American Medicine Today, presented by the Benatti Spine Institute, featuring the internationally acclaimed inventor of the Benatti Spine procedures, Alfred Benatti, MD. Once again, here are Dr. Benatti and your host, Kimberly Brummel.
Thanks for listening to American Medicine Today. I am Kimberly Brummel, joined by Ethan Uecker, Jeff Wagstaff.
Hey, Kimberly, thank you for having me.
At least we can hear you, Jeff.
I'm glad to be here, by the way.
You're a little
How
late to the party.
How many times in 3 years have I forgotten to turn on my mic? That's probably the second.
Three.
Give me a break.
Oh, come on. I think that's more like
I think it's the second time in
lies. That's okay.
All right, we have a guest on the line.
We do. And by the way, we also have Dr. David Hershauer joining us in studio from the Benatti Spine Institute, so thank you. And as well, joining us right now is Health Insurance Insider, who's choosing to remain anonymous due to potential backlash from the industry. She has some insight that she'd like to share on what really goes on in the field and what it really... what really needs to be done to get the healthcare system back on track. So we are going to call her Anne for the sake of this conversation. Thank you for joining us.
Anne.
Hi.
Hi.
I was worried that she wouldn't respond to Anne because it's not her name.
I know. But I actually had conversed back and forth with you on Facebook. Mm-hmm. And yeah. I believe it had been about Obamacare. And
it was.
You started telling me about your knowledge of the healthcare industry and what goes on with the insurance companies. And I said, I'd like to have you on the show. So, you know, what are they doing and what needs to be done to remedy Obamacare?
Well, I think that the right steps to have it repealed, the whole program from the very inception, it was not put together the way that it should have been.
Sure.
As far as a country, we need to take a look at what direction we want to go into. Do we want to continue having insurance be where it's 100%, you know, self-funded or through an employer, okay, or do we want to go more towards a socialized medicine model? And
no.
Then if we do that, do we want to provide it to where it's completely free, or do we want to make it truly affordable?
Oof.
Now, if we're looking to have affordable health care that is brought to everybody and the government subsidizes it, mm-hmm, I think that we already have a program that's been in place since 1965, which is the Medicare program.
Sure.
And it's a successful program that does genuinely deliver affordable health care.
As successful, given the fact that Obama and his administration defunded a lot of Medicare to fund Obamacare?
Yeah, that actually, that is a problem. Mm-hmm. It's very unfortunate what's been happening. It is starting to affect the benefits of the end users.
Sure.
Within the Medicare program, but...
Right.
Still, even with the way that the program is today, the Medicare program is still a successful program. But yes, the beneficiaries are feeling the pinch from the funding being redirected.
And I certainly understand and respect why you want to remain anonymous. But maybe you could tell us a little bit about your background in the healthcare mm-hmm industry, just so folks understand where you're coming from.
Yeah, I have been a licensed agent in my state since 2006, and I primarily am a Medicare expert. That's where I specialize in is the Medicare system, okay, although I do also do, you know, health care and the Affordable Care Act or the Obamacare, although I did opt out of doing it this last year for a variety of reasons, but... I have been certified to do the Affordable Care Act since the inception of the program as well.
Anne, I thought it was very interesting in the notes that you sent mm-hmm me that when Obamacare was first passed, you said that the government used quote-unquote thug tactics,
yes,
wouldn't allow you and the company that you worked for to speak with the media.
Mm-hmm.
An investigation was opened on your company, and without giving names, of course, of who you worked for. What was that all about, and what was the results of that investigation?
Well, that was actually a really surreal experience. At the time, I was working for that company. The American Care Act, or the Affordable Care Act, was being put into place, and Obama was doing some kind of underhand tactics with getting the bill to go through without anybody actually reading it. This was a 2,700-page document that nobody knew what was in it.
You got to pass it to read
right
it.
Right. That was a Pelosi thing.
That's what they
yes
said, right.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a disaster just waiting to happen. I mean, what could go wrong with that, right?
Of course.
Now, we all heard about that, about you have to read it to understand, or we have to pass it to understand what's in it. But
so ridiculous.
From your perspective, but, though, what were the thug tactics that the administration used? You kind of saw it from a different light.
What happened with my particular company is my company, they wrote communications to their membership base and let them know that, you know, what the Affordable Care Act was and that it could affect their benefits moving forward into the future. And if they didn't want that, to contact their local government representatives.
Right.
And so because of doing that, there was an investigation that was opened up by CMS, which is the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid. They're kind of the government governing agency for both the Affordable Care Act and Medicare.
Okay.
And real quick, we've only got a little less than a minute left. I'm curious, what was it like inside of insurance company while the Affordable Care Act was in legislature being passed? What did the management and the senior people within the insurance company, how did they feel?
Well, you know, we really weren't allowed to talk too much about the government or any of the policies at the time that this was happening. It was, like I said, it was very surreal. We were on CNN and, right, and Fox News. There was one time I was actually in an appointment and the lady had CNN on and my company was on there and she was asking me what we did wrong. You know, the management, it got very, very like tense and tight mouthed and, you could tell that it was a very big deal.
So to paraphrase, the only thing you guys did wrong was alerting your client base about Obamacare.
That's correct. That's all they did. And, that was the heart of the investigation. They wanted CMS wanted to investigate if our company did something wrong by informing their membership base, because the company that I worked for is a private company, even though it is, you know, in connection.
To summarize, because we're out of time, they were saying you guys didn't allow your people to opt in to receive that email, and so they got you, your company, involved and saying that you guys did the wrong thing, and then it turns out that CMS accidentally sent out a letter to all their clientele doing the same thing, but it never got media coverage.
Interesting.
That's correct. Yeah, that was kind of the unofficial backlash of the investigation. The official investigation said that our company didn't do anything wrong, but in the future that people had to opt in to government and then they just prior to the annual enrollment period that year, they sent out a letter to all of the Medicare recipients saying that this particular company had left the state.
Well,
and that was the accident.
And this is a topic that could just go on forever and a day. Unfortunately, we are out of time. We do appreciate you coming on the show and even using an alias, but at least trying to get to the heart of the problem with what goes on with insurance companies and this whole debacle we've come to know as Obamacare. Thank you.
Yes. Thanks for coming on.
Absolutely. All right. My
take care.
Have a good weekend.
Have a good day.
Yep. Bye-bye.
Make sure you stay tuned, because coming up after the break, we're going to talk about doctor-patient relationships and how they've kind of declined over the years. Make sure you stay tuned. You're listening to American Medicine Today.
This is the first time that I am pain-free after 18 years, and it's just wonderful. I love it.
Phenomenal results, no pain whatsoever.
My pain is virtually gone, nothing short of a miracle.
Those surgeries gave me my life back.
Already, I feel like a new person.
I'm going home new. I can chase my grandbaby now, I can garden, I can cook, and I'm really thrilled. The outcome has been remarkable.
I feel 100% better.
It's like a miracle.
It was phenomenal. It literally did change my life.
I was in a wheelchair at that time, and I left here walking.
Every single pain that I had when I came here is gone.
I'm ready to go home and feel great. This place is great. Thank you.
everything that they said they would do, they have done, and I'm very, very satisfied and happy with those results.
I knew in surgery, in fact, I told the surgeon when he relieved the pain off the nerve.
The pain is gone. I'm feeling wonderful.
I have no pain. I feel better than I felt in 4 years from the surgery. It was almost immediate relief.
Today I am totally pain-free, which is just amazing. It's fantastic.
It definitely works. I mean, I really don't know what else to tell you. I'm happy.
Listening to American Medicine Today, presented by the Bonatti Spine Institute, featuring the internationally acclaimed inventor of the Bonatti Spine procedures, Alfred Bonatti, MD. Once again, here are Dr. Bonatti and your host, Kimberly Brummel.
Thanks for joining us on American Medicine Today. I'm Kimberly Brummel, joined by Ethan Uecker.
Glad to be here.
Jeff Wagstaff.
Good day. Thanks for having me.
And Dr. David Hershauer of the Bonatti Spine Institute. Thank you for filling in for Dr. Bonatti.
Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. Joining us right now is Dr. Ronald Epstein, Professor of Family Medicine, Psychiatry, and Oncology at the University of Rochester School of Medicine and author of the new book, Attending Medicine, Mindfulness and Humanity. Thanks for joining us, Dr. Epstein.
A pleasure to be here.
Now, Doc, tell us what happened to you as a third-year med student at Harvard that first got you thinking about physician mindfulness.
Well, actually, this was something that only later got me thinking about it. But I really noticed the difference between two surgeons that I was working with. You know, I was a third-year student, not very sophisticated medically, but I could see that one surgeon was really paying attention in a different way than the other. And it came to a head because there were actually two events, one in each operation with each surgeon, that were handled strikingly differently. In the first, a surgeon was completely oblivious to an evolving disaster, even when his attention was brought to that. Wow. And the second, the surgeon seemed to have a capacity for anticipating and being more mindful and present so that he was able to see an evolving disaster before anyone else noticed. And that really struck me because both of these were well-known, reputable, otherwise considered to be excellent surgeons in a very good hospital. But I saw that there was a qualitative difference in the way that they approach the work that they do.
Well, and that's what you get into, is that there's mm-hmm. a difference between quote-unquote masterful doctors and those that are just merely competent. What mm-hmm. is that difference?
I think it's a quality of mind. I think it's an ability to pay attention in a particular way, not only to what's outside you, but also your own intuitions, your own feelings, and also what is coming in to you in the way of sensations. It has to do with curiosity, keeping an open mind, as opposed to feeling that you that you know what's going on, and just maintaining this little bit of doubt that perhaps something could go wrong. The third is third quality is presence, just being there and being undistracted, and patients know that. And the last quality is what I call the beginner's mind, the ability to see a familiar situation with new eyes.
Yes.
How much does compassion enter into that relationship? Empathy, compassion.
Well, I think everyone, if you ask them, would say that a compassionate doctor is a better doctor. And in fact, I would say that medicine is nothing without compassion, because compassion really means acting on behalf of another person and to some extent feeling their suffering. If you don't have that capacity, I don't think you can be a good doctor. The problem is that we don't really teach people to build their capacity to be more compassionate. It's very easy to be compassionate in situations that are low stress and where everyone's on the same page. But it's much harder to be compassionate when you and the patient are different, or when you have to deliver bad news, or when things don't go well, or when you're facing really tough decisions. That really stretches all of us, and we don't really get any way of learning how to do that better during medical training.
So you believe because there isn't really training on that, that's why the doctor-patient relationship has deteriorated over, say, the past 50 years?
Oh, you know, I think it's a complicated question. That may be part of it.
Okay.
I think also there are just so many more distractions that doctors have to deal with. 50 years ago, we just didn't know that much. Even when I was a medical student in the 80s, the choices of medications for diabetes or blood pressure or cancer or HIV disease, I mean, there were just very, very few options. And now there are many. And just the amount of information we have to master, and then the distractions that all the electronic devices that we have to deal with, mm-hmm. you know, computers, cell phones,
right.
Various mechanical devices, you know, they draw our attention away from face-to-face contact with patients. So I think medicine's become more challenging. It's not just a failure of empathy and compassion. But I think that if we're not aware, if we're not self-aware mm-hmm. of how those distractions are affecting our relationships, then we can't do anything about it.
See, a lot.
So awareness is really the first step.
And a lot of the doctors that we've spoken mm-hmm. with about physician burnout and things like that
yes.
have a lot to do with insurance obligations and just
paperwork
administrative
yes.
stuff that doctors have to deal with and jumping through hoops. And basically, they have to double the amount of patients, or triple or quadruple, I don't know the actual figure, but they have to see so many patients in a day
right.
just to stay on top of things that time that is spent with a patient one-on-one just is non-existent anymore.
Well, I'm a primary care doctor, and in primary care, it's probably hit the worst, and I feel it every day. And there are workarounds and ways of mitigating the stress, but it clearly is very, very real. Part of it's rooted in terms of what we reimburse for medical care. You know, if I, as a primary care doctor, if I have a patient who comes in with a wart and I use liquid nitrogen on it, which takes about 3 seconds, I would get paid double than if I spent a half an hour talking with someone about some difficult end-of-life decision. And that's wrong. It shouldn't be that way, that the valuing of conversation, of relationships, of getting to know patients as people really needs to be emphasized more in the way that doctors are reimbursed. And also the regulatory environment has just gotten totally out of hand. The amount of time that we spend filling out forms and also even documenting things in a medical chart to assure that we'll be reimbursed, often those things have no bearing whatsoever on the quality of healthcare. And ironically, actually, they're often called meaningful use requirements, which is really anything but.
Dr. Epstein, as a layperson, I bring to the show broadcast experience, not a medical background. In my primary care physician's office, there are more people who deal with administrative duties and insurance than actually interact with the patient. And as a patient, you can just tell something's wrong with that when you go to a doctor and there's more people pushing paper than taking care of people. But the reason I ask you the question about the compassion is I can't imagine what physicians deal with on a daily basis emotionally dealing with life or death issues. And I was curious if compassion sometimes could almost be a hindrance that a good physician has to remain objective. I didn't know if the emotion can, of course it can help in some areas, but I also thought it might hurt in some areas. That's got to be a really difficult thing to maneuver as the person of the doctor.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And that's why I think that we all need better training in doing that. Because, first of all, when you're compassionate towards someone, you actually personally feel a sense of reward. Okay, we all know this. You know, when you do something good for someone else, and we know that in terms of the chemistry of our own brains, we have more dopamine release in our brain, and dopamine is kind of what they call a reward hormone. It makes you feel better about yourself, a sense of accomplishment or joy. And so compassion is a good thing. The problem comes is in order to feel compassion, to some extent, we all feel pain. We feel the suffering of the patients who are with us. And if you don't have a good way of distinguishing the patient's pain from your own resonance with that pain, then you can really get caught up in it. So it's not a question of being cold or distant. In fact, I think it's a question of being even more present, but that presence needs to be boundaried. You need to understand where you end and where the patient begins. Mm-hmm. And that, I think, is a learned skill. We're not born doing that. We were born to resonate with one another. And what often happens in medical training is because that sense of pain that we feel when encountering suffering, many doctors just withdraw. They don't know any other way of dealing with it other than to be more distant, less emotionally available.
Let me stop
and in that
you
way,
there.
They impoverish themselves. Yeah.
When you mention that, what can patients do to help doctors become more mindful?
First of all, I don't think it's the patient's burden to help doctors become more anything. Patients are there because they're sick and they're suffering.
Sure.
But I think that one thing that can be useful that doctors really appreciate is if you prioritize and organize your concerns. So if you come in and you know you've got four or five things to discuss, try to figure out what's the most important and make sure your doctor knows that's the one that's the most important to you. It's particularly frustrating when a patient comes in with four or five things and then the sixth thing they come up with is the fact that their chest hurts every time they walk up a flight of stairs.
Right.
I mean, you know, that
should be the first
kind
thing.
Of important.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. That needs to be kind of, you know, I know it's scary to talk about and you don't want to think that something might be wrong with your heart,
right.
But I think it'll help your doctor and make for better health care, and your doctor will be more attentive to the things that really matter.
Well, I agree.
And if for you it's depression that's the thing that's most important,
mm-hmm.
then tell your doctor that too. I mean, right. You know, it doesn't have to be a physical complaint.
Correct. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Ronald Epstein, Professor of Family Medicine, Psychiatry, and Oncology at the University of Rochester School of Medicine and author of new book, Attending Medicine, Mindfulness and Humanity. Thank you for being on the show.
Thank you.
Thanks, doctor. Bye-bye.
Take care.
Very well-spoken,
yes.
Intelligent guest.
Oh, yeah, for
Absolutely.
Sure.
Absolutely.
Good topic.
Absolutely. We need to get that doctor-patient relationship.
Back on track.
Yes, mended.
Mm-hmm. I like that word.
Make sure you stay tuned, because coming up after the break, we're going to talk to our very own Dr. David Hershauer of the Benatti Spine Institute. You're listening to American Medicine Today.
This is the first time that I am pain-free after 18 years, and it's just wonderful. I love it.
Phenomenal results, no pain whatsoever.
My pain is virtually gone, nothing short of a miracle.
Those surgeries gave me my life back.
Already I feel like a new person.
I'm going home new. I can chase my grandbaby now, I can garden, I can cook, and I'm really thrilled. The outcome has been remarkable.
I feel 100% better.
It's like a miracle.
It was phenomenal. It literally did change my life.
I was in a wheelchair at that time, and I left here walking.
Every single pain that I had when I came here is gone.
I'm ready to go home and feel great. This place is great. Thank you.
Everything that they said they would do, they have done, and I'm very, very satisfied and happy with those results.
I knew in surgery, in fact, I told the surgeon when he relieved the pain off the nerve.
The pain is gone. I'm feeling wonderful.
I have no pain. I feel better than I felt in 4 years from the surgery. It was almost immediate relief.
Today I am totally pain-free, which is just amazing. It's fantastic.
It definitely works. I mean, I really don't know what else to tell you. I'm happy.
Listening to American Medicine Today, presented by the Benatti Spine Institute, featuring the internationally acclaimed inventor of the Benatti Spine procedures, Alfred Benatti, MD. Once again, here are Dr. Benatti and your host, Kimberly Brummel.
Thanks for continuing to listen to American Medicine Today. I'm Kimberly Brummel, joined by Ethan Uecker.
Glad to be here.
Junior Mint Jeff Wagstaff.
Yes, I am.
And we have with us in studio a member of the Benatti Spine Institute surgical team. He's the chief of pain management and anesthesiologist, Dr. David Hershauer. He's going to discuss kind of what happens behind the scenes. And, well, let's get to know you, Dr. Hershauer. Mm-hmm. Why don't you tell us how you actually came to meet Dr. Benatti?
I trained at the University of Miami. I graduated in 1992.
Okay.
And I decided I wanted to raise a family not on the east coast of Florida, but the west coast of Florida. So mm-hmm. came to St. Pete. I moved to an area called the Old Northeast.
Okay.
And Dr. Benatti at the time was living there also. And through friends, he heard that maybe I wasn't as happy with my job that I had at the time. Mm-hmm. Heard there was a doc in town that was starting a new service called pain management. Mm-hmm. It was relatively kind of new to the field back then. So one night he came to my house, knocked on the door. He has, I think, 17 or 18 poodles with him because that's his passion,
did, yes.
his dogs.
A flock uh-huh. of poodles, and, Dr. Benatti yeah. style.
Yes, I know that flock. Oh, no, that was a flock of seagulls. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So he knocked on my door and introduced himself, and of course I knew who he was because I had put out the feelers to go toward, you know, for my friends to contact
sure.
him. So he did knock on the door, and we started talking, and he had a vision for pain management to be worked into his practice because
right.
the surgeries are as effective then as they are now. But sometimes after the surgery, there is some discomfort, and we thought that if we used epidural steroid injections, mm-hmm. that would really smooth out the patient's course.
Right.
So we typically will do that a day after surgery, and it really works well, and the patients have almost no pain after the surgery. So he right. said, you know, I would like to start a service, and I would like to have you come work with us.
Mm-hmm.
And we worked together on this, which we did, and we developed a system that basically – there's no discomfort after the surgery.
That's fantastic. Now, just to put this in reference to time, this is, what, 22
That's
years
what
ago?
That's what I was going to ask. How long ago was this?
I came to work for him in 1995.
Wow.
That's great.
Mm. I was a sophomore in high school
yeah.
at the time.
Well, that's a testament to what they do at the Benatti Spine
Absolutely.
Institute mm-hmm. and the methods. Now, why don't you talk about conscious IV sedation? Because we're always discussing how that works.
Hey, you know, it's kind of interesting. And listening to Mr. Warner, he mentioned during the surgery he didn't remember a lot.
Right.
Which, that's part of the drugs we give. However, I guarantee you, during that surgery, he was communicating with us.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the beauty of our anesthesia. It's called conscious sedation,
right.
which means sedated, awake, but not all the way asleep.
Sure.
So and even if they don't remember after the fact, they're lucid at the time, right?
Yes.
It's kind of like when somebody has a little too much to drink, and the next day they're like, I don't remember. But at the time, they were functioning and talking and all of that stuff.
The drugs we give cause what's called retrograde amnesia,
okay.
which means you don't forget who you are.
Right.
You just forget that time period for the next 2 or 3 hours.
Because you're not laying down new memories during that
right,
time
exactly.
frame.
Right.
But then again, a lot of people do remember everything.
We've had people saying, I remember singing.
Yeah.
I remember telling jokes.
They said it was fun.
Right. And in one of my procedures, you were the anesthesiologist. And I remember interacting, and you were great telling me what he was going to do next. And
everyone's differently. You know, people react differently to the medication. And
yes.
there are people that require more.
Mm-hmm.
than others. You, Kimberly, didn't require a whole lot because
right. I'm a lightweight.
You're kind of pure, yeah.
She weighs like 10 pounds. I mean, look at the girl.
So, and you also wanted to really watch.
Yes.
Some people start out with their eyes covered and say, there's no way, absolutely no way in the world I could watch this.
Mm-hmm.
And we say, okay, well, it would really help if you do.
Right.
And
why does it help if they do?
Okay, well,
it
what happens,
out
Ethan?
At the moment.
Our surgery is based on doing no harm.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, we've all heard about horror stories of someone that had spinal surgery and they wake up in recovery room and they have severe pain. Maybe an arm doesn't work. Maybe
right.
a leg doesn't work.
Right.
Well, how does that happen?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Remember, in big spinal surgery, you're asleep. It's general anesthesia. You are totally unconscious.
For the duration of
for
the procedure.
For the duration of the procedure. Mm-hmm. So the surgeon's in there mm-hmm. working, and these vests, these nerves that we work on, these structures are very tiny.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay, and they're doing the best they can not to injure that nerve. But if they accidentally do you think the patient's going to be able to tell them, ow, ow, that hurts? Of course not. They're
Correct.
They're unconscious.
If they're completely
okay?
unconscious. Right.
The difference is with us, we can't cause any pain. We
yeah.
can't cause any damage to the nerve because you actually talk to us. You tell us, that's my leg or that's my arm. And Dr. Bonatti wants to know that because mm-hmm. that tells him, oh, we're getting close to the nerve. Mm-hmm. We got to be super careful.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. And when they feel it, it's interesting because I even know with my surgery, I kept saying, I feel a little bit here. And all of a sudden he moved and he saw the bone right in to the nerve.
And
yes, great.
You participate.
Side yes. note on that, and you probably remember during Kimberly's procedure, because I was in there as well, kind of sitting in the background uh-huh. watching. It was really funny because Doc is trying to get you to communicate, and he's like, does that feel a little better? And you're like, I don't know. Every time she kept answering like, well, maybe. Oh, I don't know. And Doc's like, does it feel better or not? It was just funny because
right.
And that's Kimberly's personality. Like, you know, do you want to go eat here or you want to go eat here? Well, I don't know. Let's talk
about
it.
Well, I wanted to make sure he knew he hadn't found it yet. And all of a sudden
you were testing him. That's what you were doing.
Well, I was trying in a nice way. You know,
when
it's always
he finds that area, Kimberly,
oh,
you know
instant.
It. And you tell him. And
yes.
then, you know, he knows he's identified the focus of your pain.
Yeah. Yes.
So remember, mm-hmm. by being awake, if you can do it, it works so great. And our patients, here's Mr. Warner said, I hardly remember. Mm-hmm. But you know what? When he got to recovery room, he gave us a complete analysis to see if his pain is gone. Hmm. When you're under
correct.
General anesthesia, if you're a big open surgery, no, mm-hmm. you have no idea.
Right.
You're
sure.
so out of it. But our patients, they get to, first of all, they're in the operating room, and mm-hmm. if their pain isn't gone, then we're not done.
Correct. Mm-hmm.
Now, by chance, if we get the patient in recovery room, they go, oh, maybe this isn't so good. I still have some pain. Guess what
right
we
back
do?
In.
Right back into surgery.
Yep.
Aw.
All right. Well, we're actually, there's a lot more to talk about with you, and we'll probably have you in again next week.
Yes.
But for now.
Thank you so much for sharing your time with us.
Great insight.
Welcome.
Yes, Dr. Hirschauer of the Bonatti Spine Institute. Well, that about wraps up the program. We're going to say goodbye to our flagship station, 970 WFLA. But if you're listening on one of those other stations, make sure you stay tuned because we'll have more.
We're going to talk to a Moffitt cancer
yes.
doctor, Dr. Brian Zernicki, about the
breast cancer vaccine.
So that's coming up next.
Amazing stuff. Make sure you stay tuned on the flagship station.
Revolutionary in his field, Dr. Bonatti created, perfected, and patented the Bonatti spine procedures. Using his genius, Bonatti invented precise tools necessary to minimize surgery, scarring, anesthesia, and recovery. So successful are the Bonatti spine procedures, they consistently reflect 98.75% patient satisfaction. 50,000 successful procedures have been performed exclusively at our location. Over half our patients have suffered from failed back and neck surgeries at other facilities. Bonatti succeeds where others fail.
You're listening to American Medicine Today, presented by the Bonatti Spine Institute, featuring the internationally acclaimed inventor of the Bonatti spine procedures, Alfred Bonatti, MD. Once again, here are Dr. Bonatti and your host, Kimberly Brummel.
Thank you for joining us on American Medicine Today. I'm Kimberly Brummel, joined by my friend Ethan Uecker.
Glad to be here as always.
Now, joining us right now is Dr. Brian Zernicki, chair of the Department of Breast Oncology at the Moffitt Cancer Center here in Tampa. He's on to discuss his groundbreaking work in developing a vaccine for breast cancer. Thank you for joining us, Dr. Zernicki.
Thank you for having me.
Now, Doc, give us some statistics here. We mm-hmm. all hear, and most of us even know people who have been afflicted and affected
yes.
by breast cancer. How many women are affected each year, if you know those figures offhand, and what led you to developing this treatment?
So it's about, if you look at invasive breast cancer, it's about 200,000 cases of invasive breast cancer mm-hmm. in a year in the United States. And then you can add to that another 50,000 to 60,000 cases of ductal carcinoma in situ, what the so-called stage zero breast cancer. So all told, about 250,000, 260,000 cases of breast cancer a year.
Wow.
And so what led you to, obviously, you've been doing this sort of oncology mm-hmm. for a long time. What led you to sort of develop this treatment?
Mm-hmm. Well, the impetus for this really is the immune system seems to play a larger role in breast cancer than we had ever given credit to. And the impetus was to develop or use the immune response, just like we do in infectious disease, in a preventive fashion more so than a treatment, because we're very successful in preventing a lot of infectious disease by being proactive and preventive.
Sure.
The same principles can potentially apply to breast cancer, accept that it's something that's coming from within, not from the outside.
Okay. Now, we know the vaccine is composed of the patient's own cells. Why don't you tell us how that works, and is it different than what we're hearing about immunotherapy?
So it is immunotherapy. It's a component of immunotherapy.
Okay.
It's the reason why it's made from the patient's own cells is that we specifically are trying to hone down on getting the immune response right.
Okay.
And we can control how the immune response activates the lymphocytes in the body
mm-hmm.
by instructing those cells in different ways. And so what we do with this is we actually just take the cells that are responsible for activating the immune response
mm-hmm.
and getting the lymphocytes activated. We can take them out of the peripheral blood, and we can instruct them in such a way to say that a breast cancer protein is more like a virus than a self protein, and it activates lymphocytes to then go attack it.
Okay.
Yeah, see
what
that.
We,
go ahead.
What we didn't know is that actually, as we started to thumb through this over the years, what we found out is that healthy women actually walk around with a pretty good immune response against a lot of the things that drive breast cancer. And that they actually lose it as breast cancer starts to develop. And so we're actually not really vaccinating, but we're really trying to restore an immune response that gets lost to correct the problem.
And what is that response rate?
So in the response rate when we vaccinate people, about 85% of them, somewhere between 85 and 90%, pick up their immune response against some of the breast cancer antigens. So what we targeted first was a subcomponent of breast cancer called HER2-positive breast cancer.
Mm-hmm.
And so we started vaccinating people with early stage zero breast cancer to see if we could get the immune response, which is partially at that point being inhibited,
okay,
to correct itself. And we did it before people went to surgery so we could actually see if the immune response can actually cause the breast cancer cells to die. And what we saw in about 30% of patients was their disease actually disappeared within 6 weeks of when we were doing these vaccines prior to surgery.
That's fantastic.
Wow.
And so the same thing doesn't happen, though, if they have invasive cancer. Once it's invasive, the immune response goes further down. It's going to either take longer or we're going to have to give it a stronger punch with the immune system. But that component we're working on. But the same thing is also being applied to women who've been treated. But, you know, a lot of women, they're going to get treated, they're going to get chemo, and they're going to get Herceptin, but they're still going to be at risk for it to come back.
Mm-hmm.
And so at that point, we're trying to vaccinate people a la like the shingles vaccine, where you've already had chickenpox, but you're boosting your immunity to keep it from coming back.
Okay. I have to ask, because breast cancer does run in my family on both sides.
Okay.
So what is a good diagnostic to track early cancer? I mean, are there blood tests? I've heard, you know, everyone says mammograms, but I mean, they squash and they do different things. But I've heard like sonograms and different things like that detect cancer much sooner than mammograms.
Sonograms are best in people with dense breast tissue. Doing screening sonogram is not really the best.
Okay.
Tool. MRI is probably a little better, although it's more expensive and more time-consuming. Now they're developing MRIs that are faster.
Okay.
And then the Tomo, the 3D mammogram, is also being put together with contrast now. So.
And what is it called again, Tomo?
It's a little like a MRI. Excuse me?
What was the name of that MRI?
That's so the MRI, there's a rapid sequence MRI.
Okay.
And then there's also now what's being called contrast digital mammography, where you're taking a 3D mammogram and marrying it with contrast.
Okay.
So it's more like an MRI almost.
Got it.
Interesting. Yeah. Mm. And what really sort of captivated me with this, doctor, is just the idea of it being a vaccine now, which is a bit of a misnomer in the sense that it's not something that could be mass produced for everyone because it's developed using your own cells. So this is something that would have to be tailor-made to every single woman, correct?
No. So if you get into the pure prevention, like in the direction we're trying to head with this, mm-hmm. you can mass produce it. So the proteins we do, once we have the sequence right by getting the cells in the right order, mm-hmm. if you're talking about prevention, it will be much easier to do a mass-produced vaccine to get it to work that way to boost an immune response. What we're trying to see now is do people lose their immune response before they start to get the cancer, or does it happen only when it starts?
Okay.
Because if there are people that lose that response that they're walking around with, that's good for mm-hmm. whatever reason, for stress, for breastfeeding, pregnancies. Mm-hmm. If they lose that, maybe we can intervene and correct it before they actually start to get a cancer.
So is this something that would be covered by insurance?
Eventually, once it's approved.
Okay. And taking the same approach that you do with breast cancer, could this in turn be utilized to combat other types of cancer?
Well, the same principles can apply, yes. Okay. So for the one we're targeting, HER2, it's involved in some ovarian cancer, some lung cancer, some
sure.
stomach cancers, a few other types of cancers. But there are other similar drivers of cancer mm-hmm. that we're looking into where it looks like the same kind of thing is happening where you're losing the immune response. And
yes.
if that ends up being the case, we can apply this kind of theory to
and,
any kind of solid tumor, yeah.
And does it work on men, too? Because, honestly...
prostate cancer?
Well, I was going to say breast cancer in men, which was something that most
too.
People don't even think
yes.
of. You just associate breast cancer with females, and mm-hmm. there's a whole subset of that
yes.
where it afflicts males, too.
Yeah, so mm-hmm. it happens in men. About 1% of all breast cancers are in males. It, interestingly, though, males rarely get HER2-positive breast cancer. They get estrogen-positive breast cancers. Okay. But we have some vaccines that we're working on that are on estrogen tumors, and the other one, the triple-negative tumors, we have some that we're working on for each of those.
Wow. Thank you so much. Fascinating topic. Dr. Brian Zernicki, chair of the Department of Breast Oncology at the Moffitt Cancer Center here in Tampa. Thank you for being on the program and sharing your development of this vaccine for breast cancer.
Thank you.
Take care.
Thanks, doctor.
Bye.
Bye-bye. That's good news for a lot of people listening and
Absolutely.
Watching.
Absolutely.
Sure.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Make sure you stay tuned because coming up after the break, you'll hear more. Thanks for listening to American Medicine Today.
Revolutionary in his field, Dr. Banati created, perfected, and patented the Banati spine procedures. Using his genius, Banati invented precise tools necessary to minimize surgery, scarring, anesthesia, and recovery. So successful are the Banati spine procedures, they consistently reflect 98.75% patient satisfaction. 50,000 successful procedures have been performed exclusively at our location. Over half our patients have suffered from failed back and neck surgeries at other facilities. Banati succeeds where others fail.